Hello everyone. In this video, I want to show you how the results of PCA, principal component analysis, can be linked with some well-known results in linear algebra. So first, I will review with you some very important results. So we start with a random vector. And in my notation, vectors are always row vectors. We have a row vector x with x1, x2, all the way to xp. Then we have that sigma is the covariance matrix. So what results can we obtain for this matrix? So the first important result is the following. The matrix sigma is symmetric and positive definite. So if we want to give a proof, then of course the covariance of xi xj is equal to the covariance of xj and xi, and that proves the symmetry. Let's see for the positive definiteness. What does it mean? It means that if I multiply my matrix sigma with some vector w, so assume that w is the vector w1, w2, all the way to wp, then what we need is that w times sigma times w transpose, I use the prime for the transpose, that this is always positive. However, you know that this here is the variance of w1 x1 plus w2 x2 all the way to wp xp. And we know that a variance is always positive. And it is a strict inequality because we assume that w is not equal to zero. Let's have a look at the following important property. The following property says that the eigenvalues of my matrix sigma are positive and they're all different. So we have p different positive eigenvalues. Also here the proof is simple. If we go back to the results of PCA, then we know that the variance of the ith principal component zi, that this variance is equal to lambda I. So the eigenvalues, lambda I, they correspond with variances of random variables. And a variance is always positive. So that's why the eigenvalues of the covariance matrix have to be positive. The third important result is the following. The eigenvectors alpha 1, alpha 2, all the way to alpha p are orthogonal eigenvectors and they also have a norm 1. It means that they are orthonormal vectors. We can then define the matrix A. The matrix A is a matrix where I put the eigenvectors alpha 1, alpha 2 and so on in the columns of the matrix. Then this matrix A is an orthogonal matrix and an orthogonal matrix has the property that the inverse of the matrix is equal to its transpose. So if we recapitulate, we start from a covariance matrix sigma, we calculate the eigenvectors and the eigenvalues, then we find that the eigenvalues are positive and the eigenvectors are orthonormal and the inverse of the A matrix is equal to its transpose. And I remember that I put the transpose not equal to the T, but I use the prime notation. Okay, so we will use these results to show how you can switch from the base, the normal traditional basis vectors, to the new basis vectors alpha 1, alpha 2, all the way to alpha p. Note also that If we start from a symmetric covariance matrix, then you can prove that the eigenvectors are orthogonal with norm 1. However, the way we did it in the PCA is by not proving that the eigenvectors are orthogonal with norm 1. No, we started from the covariance matrix and then we were looking for alpha 1 and alpha 2 such that these vectors are orthogonal and have norm 1. And then the result we got was that the alphas should correspond with the eigenvectors. Right? So we didn't prove that the eigenvectors are orthogonal and have norm 1. Now we were looking for vectors that are orthogonal and have norm 1 and we found that it has to be the eigenvectors. But anyway, we have the result here. Assume that I start with a point A in RP and I can look at A from my normal basis vectors. So I have the coordinates x1, x2 all the way to xp. That's what I normally do. What I want to do now is I want to switch to a new basis. And I call this basis B. And instead of using the normal basis vectors, I now use the basis vectors alpha 1, alpha 2, all the way to alpha p. And now I can express my point A in that new coordinate system. And that's why I use a red color to indicate that it is A viewed from a different viewpoint. It's not from the old coordinate system, it's the new system. I also put the alpha here to indicate it's the point A viewed from the alpha system. And now A is called z1, z2, all the way to zp. It means that I can use z1, z2, zp to identify A, or I can use x1, x2, xp to identify that same point. I switch from the old blue system to the new red alpha system. How can we link these two systems? I can write that A, and note that I write A in blue, meaning I'm going to express A in the old system. But in order to express A in this old system, I'm going to use the alphas and the z's. So I'm going to express A in the old system, given that I know the new system. What I can write is A is equal to, it's z1 times the vector alpha 1 plus z2 times the vector alpha 2 all the way to zp, the vector alpha p. It means that I show that A, the point A in the old system, is a linear combination of the basis vectors alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha p and the weights z1, z2, zp. Note that I write it down in blue. It means that the point A and also the vectors alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha p, I all express them in terms of the old system. So the alpha 1 that you see here, it's the basis vector of your new system, but expressed in the old system. I can rewrite this a bit because A is x1, x2, xp. We have it here. And then we have here this linear combination. So if I put these two together, I find the following. The first component of A in the old system, which is x1, is equal to z1 alpha 1, 1 plus z2 alpha 2, 1 all the way to zp alpha p1. x2 is equal to z1 alpha 1, 2 plus z2 alpha 2, 2 all the way to zp alpha p2. And I can continue like this. I have xp, my last coordinate for A in the old system. It's z1 alpha 1 p plus z2 alpha 2 p all the way to zp alpha pp. In order to calculate x1, what I need is, I need Z1, Z2, Zp, because these are my weights. And I need the first component of my alpha 1 vector. I need the first component of my alpha 2 vector. I need the first component of my alpha 3 vector, and so on. So it means that in order to get x1, the coordinate of A in the old system, if I want to determine that one from the new system, I need to know all my basis vectors, or at least the first component of each of the basis vectors. And then I can go from the z to the x components. On the previous slide, we expressed the point A as a linear combination of the basis vectors, the new basis vectors, alpha 1, alpha 2, and so on. What is the intuition of this result? So if we have the following system, so our usual system for representing points, and assume that A, the point A, is here. Then we know that A has some x1 value and it has some x2 value. Assume now that there are two new axes. For example, we have this new red system. And assume that alpha 1 is here, and assume that alpha 2 is here. Then what we do is we say, well, if we want to express A, we can also take a linear combination of this vector and this vector. By combining this alpha 1 and alpha 2 vector in the correct way, I can get this vector here. So the green vector is a linear combination of the alpha 1 and the alpha 2 vector. What are the weights? If we look at the point A in terms of the z of the alpha 1, alpha 2 basis, then the first coordinate is z1. What is z1? z1 is the length from the origin to the projection. Same for z2. z2 is somewhere here. So how do I determine z1 and z2? z1, as you can see, is on the red alpha 1 axis. So I can, to get z1, to get this point here, I can start with the vector alpha 1. That's what you see here in the equation. I start with the alpha 1 vector and then I scale it. I just make it a bit longer or a bit shorter, such that I end up in this point. So in this case, if alpha 1 has to be increased in length, so I walk over this red line until I hit the projection, and that is z1. So that scaling that you see here with z1, you start from the vector alpha 1, you scale it until you have the correct length. And the same holds for the second part. You start in the alpha 2 direction and then you scale that vector such that you have the z2. And because alpha 1 and alpha 2 are two orthogonal vectors, you can always express your point A as a linear combination of the alpha 1 and the alpha 2. And the weights are exactly the z1 and the z2 and the z3 coordinates. So we call that the matrix A contains the alpha 1, alpha 2 until alpha p vector. And in the first column, we have the alpha 1 vector. In the second column, we have the alpha 2 vector. And that continues. And in the last column, we have the alpha p vector. X is a row vector containing x1, x2, all the way to xp, and z is also a row vector containing the z1 until zp. Then our formula we had on the previous slides showed that in order to get the x coordinates, what we should do is we should do z, the vector z, times a prime. Because if we multiply the row vector z with a prime, for example, to get x1, we take the row vector z times the first row of A, meaning we multiply the z's with these alphas. So it means to get x1, we have to take the first component of each alpha vector, meaning alpha 1, 1, alpha 2, 1, all the way to alpha p1. To get the x2, we take the second row of our matrix A, and so on. This result that you see here can be used to go from the new basis to the old basis. Indeed, if I have the values for z, so the point A expressed in the new basis, then I can multiply these values with A prime to get x, my point A, that same point A in the old basis. Assume now we want to go from the old basis to the new basis. It means that we know the values for x and we want to calculate the values of z. So if we have that x is equal to z times A prime, we can multiply both sides by A. Then we get x times A is z times A prime times A. But now we call that A prime is equal to the inverse. A prime is a transpose, and because that A is a vector, is a matrix with eigenvectors from a symmetric positive definite matrix, we have that the transpose and the inverse are the same. It means that this here is the identity matrix. So what we find is that in order to calculate z, we have to do x times a. So the matrix A is used to go from the x values to the z values. Let's write it down in equations instead of matrix notation. Then we find that z1, the first component of z, is equal to, I do x times a, meaning the row vector x times the first column of a, but in the columns of a we have alpha 1, so that's basically x1 times alpha 1 1 plus x2 alpha 1 2 all the way to xp alpha 1 p. And then you see to calculate z1, I only need the alpha 1 vector, because this is basically the inner product of x times alpha 1. So if I know only alpha 1, I can calculate z1 from the x values. And if I determine z2, it's x1 alpha 2 1 plus x2 alpha 2 2 all the way to xp alpha 2p, because that is the vector, row vector x times the second column of A, and in the second column of A we have alpha 2. So this is basically x times the inner product with alpha 2. So in order to calculate z2, I only need the vector alpha 2. And that continues, and in order to calculate zp, we have x1 alpha p1 plus x2 alpha p2 all the way to xp alpha pp, which is the vector x times inner product with alpha p. And there you go. So then you see, I hope, the difference between going from the x, the old system, to the z values, and going from the z values, the new system, to the old system, the x values. If I go from the old system to the new system, from x to z, in order to calculate z1, I need alpha 1. To calculate z2, I need alpha 2, and so on. If I want to go back, so going back from my z values to my original old basis x, I need all the alpha values, because If I want to calculate x1 from the z values, I need the first component of alpha 1, the first component of alpha 2, the first component of alpha 3, and so on. So I need all the first components of my alpha vectors. To calculate x2, I need all my alpha vectors, and I need for each alpha vector the second component, and so on. So we have A, the matrix A within the columns, the eigenvectors, that is to go from x to z, the transpose, because that's the inverse matrix, that is to go from z to x.